Good morning. Oh, nice. Yeah. So I'll be speaking on cybersecurity and protection of databases, challenges and opportunities. So I'm Dr. Tabrez Ahmad. I'm currently Pro Vice-Chancellor of the Galgotia University and also Dean Faculty of Law. We have 18 schools, one of the very diversified universities in the country. We have almost all the courses, and we have 21,000 students that from India and the foreign countries. We also focus very seriously on cybersecurity, or we have a law school. We focus on IPR and cyber law and all. So I'll just try to see the protection of databases in the light of the cybersecurity, because currently the way demand is growing, because everything is now governed by data. And if you see India, because of the geo revolution, the consumption of data has gone very high. So India has become one of the very few countries who is consuming very high number of data. Before geo, it was a very costly affair to use YouTube and other channels and all, because you pay very high price, and it was going behind the pocket of the people. But geo has revolutionized the entire process. So talking about India, it is now very high consumption data in the country. You see the global scenario everywhere now, because data is not a local issue, data is a global issue. And you see the European Union has given a very important area of GDPR, one of the very good laws in the world that on the data protection. And also America is moving forward. The president is going forward and is going to give the strategy for data protection in USA. India also on the same line, we in the process of going to make the data protection law in the country. It already bill is in the process. In this session, they're going to present in the parliament, and we hope that it will become a law very soon. So the background is that now data is new oil. Now we used to say that the person who has a lot of oil and all earlier than steel and all will be the leading the world. But now we are saying that data is new oil. So anybody who has a lot of data, and he has also know that how to use data, how to analyze the data, and also how to go benefit from data. So talk about data, because as per the IPR, that copyright law, because data is mostly compilation, so data is a part of the copyright law. But now data has a lot of aspects, because if you see, because of the social sites and all, and because of the compilation, because of the boundaries, global, because of the internet, now the whole challenge is how to protect the data. So if you go for the protection of the data, that is not a local issue, but I feel it's a global issue, because data will be flowing different parts of the world. If you see about just the payment of the price, you may be paying in Dubai, maybe from the foreign country. So you are paying by your credit cards in Dubai, but see the way the information is flowing, maybe several countries. So it's not only a local issue, it is a global issue. So that's why now all the very fast growing economies, already they are in the process. I just mentioned European Union already given very good GDPR law, America is in process, India is also very soon going to provide the data protection law. If you talk about cybersecurity, you know, very important area to do research and also to do the regulation part, because cybersecurity is also a global issue, and simply by just having the law will not help you. So it requires a lot of integration with the cybersecurity experts and lawyers to sit together and to understand about the regulation part of the cyberspace. Because generally it is very rare to have teaching law to the engineers or the software engineers who handle cybersecurity, because generally they are just taught about the few aspects of the IPR and all, or patent innovation and all. And same way, if you go to law school, it is not those who are studying the IPR. Generally in India, if you see, even BCI has not made compulsory the knowledge of the IPR. It's an optional course. So those who are the good law school, who know the importance of the IPR, they mostly made IPR the compulsory course. But I was earlier in the University of Petroleum, so we started a course called BTEC Levy Honours in Cyber and IPR. It was a six-year program. We used to teach the entire software engineering for 4 years with law and then specialize them in the IPR and cyber law. As we're going to start the same course in Galgotia University, Greater Noida in India, that will be a six-year program, and there will be full focus on the entire understanding of the cyberspace, cybersecurity, software engineering, computer science engineering, and then basic core of the law, the BCI norms, plus giving the special focus on the cyber law and cybersecurity. Because currently, the issue is not only just handling the cases coming to the court. The entire idea is how to make a policy and a strategy. Because there is no early warning system in this process. What happens when something has go very wrong, then we are going to find out the solutions. But my point is that why not to have very well thought process and strategy, seeing the future innovations and future challenges, and then regulation should be at par with the requirement. Because see, there's a lot of fight is going on between the technocrats and lawyers that what should be the level of regulation. Any technocrat will not be accepting very high regulation, because if you go on regulating too much, you're going to impact the growth of the technology. So always as a technocrat, a technology company, you will be feeling that there should be very, very nominal kind of regulation part will be there. But as a lawyer, as a legal philosopher, a legal thinker, you'll be trying to regulate everything, because nothing should go without proper regulations and all. If you go about regulation part, if you go to different countries, every country has a different socioeconomic structure, different kind of the thought process, different religions and all, different culture. So if you talk about the regulation part, it will be also having lot of thought process about the socio-economic, cultural, and the religious aspect of that country. So how you're going to have a single law that will be regulating the entire world? But there must be some kind of the law is required that should have the at least the basic level of the protection, and that will be also not hampering the growth of the technology, as well as if anything happens in the process, anybody the loser will be able to get that will be analyzed. So in India what happens that there was a case in the country where for the first time Supreme Court has said the protection of data is a kind of the fundamental rights. So that is the, and after that government has made a committee and all, the committee has made this bill. The bill is going for the personal data protection. It also has a lot of issues because if you see about the European Union, they have taken too much time to really give a law. They have given 2 years gestation period to find out any challenges that is coming up so they can resolve. If you see the growth of data, that it is going to be 119.95 billion by 2020 from 57.22 billion in 2017. So the growth of data is very high, and that's why it is require a lot of proper thought process, and the lot of research is required. Keeping in mind the growth of the economy at the global level, because all the, if you see the currently what happening, almost every company is fighting among each other. If you see the cases between the Apple computers and the Nokia, then the Google, then versus the Facebook, and then all these what is happening, they are just trying to fight among each other and trying to challenge the innovation process and the patenting of the technology. Because if you go to the patenting level, it is very challenging to really get a patent for technology, because justifying the four requirements of patenting is very challenging in the cybersecurity level or innovation level of a technology. So that's why it's a very important area of focus. And also ultimately what's happening, the cases are going to be settled outside the court. Because if you go to the court, it will take too much time, and know the all the new technology, the gestation periods is very, very short. Because if you take 2-3 time to the court, this value of that will be gone. And because, and for that you invested a lot of money to get the patents, instead of getting back from the market, you'll be losing the entire investment for the technology. The challenge is that how we have to make the policy that is very futuristic, and how if something happens, we are able to really resolve the matter in time. So at least the person who was the real patent holder, he will be able to commercialize the in the market, plus get return from the market. So that's why the always solution is not in the court. Sometimes that's why in this field, also we have to develop the experts who can do ADR, who can do the arbitration outside the court. But the challenge is that even the arbitrator should understand the entire law, understand the entire technology, understand the policy and all. If you go to policy level, in India, there is no proper thought process to teach the policy making of the law. Very few law schools focus on the research aspect of the teaching process, where students are given some kind of hand-holding to do some research at the projects, so they can have some thinking about this policy making. Still, about the policy making part of the regulation is mostly governed by the foreign universities, and we are just simply copying and their laws. Even India, if you see Indian data protection law, it is just like a copy of the GDPR of the European Union, because very, very few areas they have changed, but still that law is actually the challenge, because it has a lot of issues currently should be resolved, because a lot of challenge last year regarding the data localization. So in this process, government has given 6 months time to all the banks and financial companies. Anybody is dealing in the payment on the online process, they have to localize the data center in India. So for example, if any company is a global company, they have 100 data centers in the world. Now they have to bring to India, and where data will be localized. So this way what happened, every company has raised the cost of more than 10%, and ultimately it was raised, the price. It was extra burden on those companies for maintaining the localization, but ultimately at least almost all the company able to maintain the local database center. This is a good process, but the point is that if any country, out of 100 country, everybody is saying, please maintain data in this country, so the company has to maintain 100 data centers. So maintaining the 100 data centers, do you feel it is viable technically? Why not to make the system so foolproof, policy so innovative, that even one data center in any part of the world will be helping all 100 countries? Because just maintaining centers in different countries is not the solution. It's just raising the cost. See, the maintenance is very, very costly affair to maintain data center. And every time then you cannot go on opening, you have to raise the business to one country, again go for data center. But ultimately it is very good for India, because India was the place almost all the foreign investors, all the IT companies, all the maybe Google or Facebook, LinkedIn, mostly they're foreign, these companies registered in the foreign place, and the entire data from India going to the foreign place, and data were analyzed, and the actual corrects of data benefits were given to the foreign countries, not to India. Because ultimately, if we see how we are going to get free of cost, no benefits from LinkedIn, Facebook, all the mails and all, because we are ultimately giving them right to analyze our data and use data. So this new law is now focusing that anybody's data is used, he should given chance to have a say, and he should be briefed properly that how data was collected, how that data will be used, and then if now the data is breached, there should be a notification to the person your data is breached, and they have to restore data. But if you would see the earlier occasions, the person's data was used and he was given consent because of the very lengthy contract and agreement. He was never seeing that line, but he has agreed. But in this process, now there should be proper communication to the person whose data was taken, how data was utilized, and then how data was actually, then this is called as right to be forgotten. Also, you have a right, the person who has data, he has a right, then he should be having the right to say that, please remove my data from the entire system. But it is very challenging. You know that as per the common saying, anything goes on the internet, it always remains there. So if something is positive, it is great. Everybody is, if you become viral, something became viral as a positive, you are actually very happy. But something goes negative as a viral, dog shit case, it is taught in the almost all the taught classes, that you will be suffering whole life. Because currently, even for job employment, marriage proposals, people may ask, please give me your Facebook ID. I want to see how you are behaving on Facebook. Or sometime, even for employment agencies, will ask, give me your social side. I want to see that how you're behaving on the social side. Because if you really see anybody's behavior on how he behaves, how he comments, how he writes about him and all, if you analyze, you can really judge about his personality, attitude, thought process, future strategy and all. So that's why he should be have a right to be forgotten, that he should say when it is to be removed from the system, and he should be taking the final decision whether data should be collected, how it should be used, how it should be commercialized. Because entire networking system, the social sites, is actually depending on the entire analysis or plus use of the technology. For example, you might have searched some the flight tickets before coming to Dubai. And next day, you will get automatic lot of the aeroplane companies sending you automatic link. We are offering 20% discount. We are from Air India or from Air France, okay, or Air Sri Lanka. You never thought, my God, I never searched the Air Sri Lanka, Air India. I was searching some other airline company, how I'm getting? You might have searched some hotels, but you will get from several hotels offering you how it is happening. So entire business has gone to the data analysis and then applying that crush of data to get commercial benefits. One way it is very, very good. But if you go to the liberty level, personal level, the fundamental rights, it is violation of fundamental rights. Unless you should give consent, no company has right to use your data. So now the question is that what data is critical and what data is not critical. In this particular the bill pending in the parliament in India, it is yet not government has decided that which data is very, very critical and which data is not critical. Because if data is not critical, there is no challenge. It is public data. But some data is very, very critical. So the power is going to the Ministry of Government of India. They have to decide which data is very, very critical. So that critical data should not be used without consent of the person. Now, so he should have a right to be forgotten on the system. Now we have seen that entire GDP is depending on data, entire data analysis, no? Data processing, data analysis, and also how you're going to use data. So it is totally linked to the economic system of any country, innovations and all. So that's why it should be read in the line of the economic development, policy making and strategy. And it is what I feel, it is not only local issue that any country simply just plan and implement, because data will be always be a global issue and data analysis will always be a very commercial in nature. And that's why if proper planning is done, it should be very useful for our personal rights, fundamental rights, also useful for commercial rights, plus the way the technology is growing, all mobile companies and all. It will be very good for the economic development of the country. And this way, we have to focus on the policy analysis as well as strategy, not only for keeping in mind the local issues, but as a global system, because now technology is the only solution for all the problems. With these words, I thank you all for patient hearing. And also, I thank the IPR Gorilla for giving me this chance to be a keynote speaker in this conference. Wish you all the best. Thank you very much.